That's not a misspelling. That says FCD. It doesn't. I'm not trying to spell NDC or something like that. We'll get to that. I work for Christie, so give me 2 seconds to tell you what I do there. I take a bunch of projectors. Christie makes projectors, which is very uninteresting. Don't know if those are Christie projectors. But what I do is take a bunch of projectors and turn them into one projector, right? So figure out where the projectors are so that I can seamlessly stitch them together. And do that for really big screens. That's probably got like 8 projectors or something like that or more on it. Do it on surfaces like basketball courts and hockey, ice, whatever, hockey. Because we're Canadian, we got to do hockey. That's Canadian Parliament Building. That's Moscow Red Square. That is a gray car. There's the cars, whatever color you would like it to be. There's like car with, you know, only being projected on parts of the car. So yellow, red, it's a blue car. Cars only this big, right? And those are our panels at the back, and we're projecting on our panels on the floor, or projecting on the floor, I don't know which. Oh yeah, that. I'll stay over here. And we shine projectors, we hit a button, and then we figure out where the object is, and we can color it whatever way you want. That's what we do. So it's really interesting stuff. I'm not gonna talk about it, sorry. But that's what I do for a day job. What I don't do in my day job is lock-free programming, because that's a scary thing to do at work. So let's start really, really at the beginning, right? What's wrong with this code here? Anyone? What might be wrong with this code? What could go wrong? Zero, right, yeah. So you put an if around it, right? Simple. So what might be wrong with this code now? Like, what if these are static variables that, you know, the whole world can see, and you're running a multi-threaded program, right? Well, you know, two things could happen. If a thread is writing B while you're reading B, then you get undefined behavior, your cat can get pregnant, anything can happen. Marshall Clough on the committee, that's his saying, your cat gets pregnant. Even if you don't own a cat. Suddenly you own a cat. So that's, you know, you were kind of worried about the divide by zero, but we have another problem that you can't even read and write B at you know, two threads at the same time. So the obvious answer is to make it an atomic, right? So, okay, now I can read and write two threads at the same time, but we still have this problem, right? It's like, well, B is not zero, but then there's this gap between the if statement and the next line of code, where another thread can come in and suddenly B is zero, right? So this if statement does nothing for you if you're in a multi-threaded environment. And because that little gap can, you know, picture in your head that gap is much bigger, right? It's a huge gap that you can drive a truck through, and anything in the world can happen in between the if and the next line of code. Because the word then, you know, if then is like a four-letter word, it's a bad word in lock-free programming, threading in general. So it's simple, but it's fundamental that we are so used to typing if statements and then assuming the rest of the world after that if statement. Like, oh, I've done an if and I know what's inside. I know what the world is like inside that if because I'm protected by this if statement. And the only trick to lock-free programming is forgetting everything you know, right? Because things like that aren't true anymore.
You must unlearn what you have learned.
Yeah. And you must forget everything you know, and forget everything you know in the sense of if you just read a variable and you think you know what the value of that variable is, you don't, right? It's gone. You knew what the variable was, you don't know what it is. This is a lock-free queue that I'm not going to really talk about much today, but you know, come to one of my longer talks and I'll explain this cue. I always have diagrams like that where it's like, oh, look, here's the state of the queue right now. And you fall into this trap. And like, this is where every bug comes from. It seems so simple, but every bug comes from you thinking you know what the state of the world is. But when you're reading this queue as a lock-free program, this is all you know. You can look at one thing at a time. You don't know what the state of the rest of the queue is in, ever. You can just look at one thing. And then even after you've looked at that one thing, it's not true anymore, right? Because it's changed. Everything changes behind your back. So you know nothing. John Snow, come on, everyone. And the other half of that is when you're writing lock-free data structures, normal C++ code inside a member function, you can just break your invariants while you do stuff, right? It's like, oh, while I'm inside this member function, I can break the world of my inside my class, but I'll restore it before I leave, right? So you can temporarily break your invariants. You can't do that in a lock-free class because every invariant must hold at all times because another thread can come in at any time and assumes your invariants still hold. So in lock-free code, it's like maintain your invariants while you do stuff. You can't break them for one line. And it's kind of, I think of that like wearing your state on your sleeve. Whatever the state of your data structure is, that state has to always be accessible by any thread. So here's our code so far, and it still has this error where B can still be zero, right? So how do we fix this? You have to read between the lines is the other way I think about this, right? It's like you're looking at two lines of code, but you have to think between every two lines of code, something else can happen. And there's the C++ 14 or so fix for it. So you just make a temporary variable, simple. And now you're protected from B changing. So there's no gap anymore. And basically what you're doing is you're taking a snapshot of B in a state and time, and grab that snapshot. And now inside the curly brackets, you don't know what B is anymore, but you're like, I saw it and I'm going to work on this stale value of B. And you have to make sure in your algorithm, it's fine to have a stale value of B. And the other part of this snapshot you should realize is that you haven't read A yet. So you're not reading A at the same time as B. So if whatever this data structure was, A and B were kind of, you know, related to each other in a certain way, like they're a ratio or something, this code is not reading a snapshot of that ratio because it has to do two reads at two different times. You have to make sure that's okay. And also, you know, that auto there doesn't even compile. Anyone know why that auto doesn't compile? Atomics don't have copy constructors. Because, you don't want temp to be another atomic. You just want it to be the integer, right? You don't want it to be an atomic integer because it's a local variable. Like you don't need it to be atomic. You don't want it to be atomic. It would be slower. It's like you want the value inside of B, not an actual copy of B. So this is a case where you don't want to use auto. You just want to use int. So that's what you really mean. Or if you really like auto, you can do it this way. You can call .load, which I'd actually argue that you should always call .load for both A and B, because I like atomic variables to look different than normal variables because they're different. And that's the important line of code, you know, like the important point in your algorithms is going to be where the atomics are touched, right? You do a bunch of stuff locally and then you touch an atomic. And you really want to be able to highlight those in your code. So I atomics got into the committee just before I showed up. I would have argued that you had to call load and store and they didn't have any conversions. Um, I already mentioned that. So, you know, if you needed to get a snapshot of A and B at the same time, does anyone know how you would do that? You basically don't do that. You could put A and B in a structure and allocate it and get a snapshot of the pointer and things like that. But basically, if you need to read two variables at the same time in atomic, in lock-free programming, you're done. You can't. You can only read one variable at a time. That's all you got to work with. The other thing you can do is smash A and B together into a small enough struct that it can be atomic, like cram it into an int or maybe 32-bit ints crammed into a 64-bit int. But if A and B are over here and over here, you can't read them at the same time. Rewrite your algorithm. And you have to remember, it's not just read between the line, it's read between the tokens, right? So that count plus plus is more than one line of code, depending on your CPU and whatnot. Obviously, the answer to that is just make that thing atomic as well. But if we imagined what does this normally do, not that the CPU really does this, but conceptually, we have to first read the value that is stored in count, put it in a register, increment the register, and then write it out, right? So it's kind of like three operations just to increment a variable. And therefore, you have a gap between the read and the write where things can change, right? So just incrementing a variable, you have to be aware of other threads. And what we'd really like to do is say, if it's not changed, then I can write the variable, right? So it's like, I read count, I'm going to increment it, and I go, well, if count hasn't changed from what it used to be, then write the memory, right? And you know, this gets us nowhere because now we've just moved the gap one line lower, right? So what we really need is this line of code and that other line of code to happen at the same time, right? To be atomic. And if we can get rid of that little gap between those two lines of code, then we can get somewhere. We can get things working. So how are we going to do that? We're going to write magic, right? Just like, magic always works. Unless you really needed two variables, then there's no magic for two variables. So let's imagine we have this magic function that does what we need. It does, if count hasn't changed, then update count. But it does it in such a way that no one can get in between those two statements. All right? And I mean, just putting into a function is not going to solve this, but imagine we had this magic function. And let's call this magic function CAS because I'm old school and it used to be called CAS. CAS stands for either compare and swap or compare and set or compare exchange, which doesn't have an A and S in it, but that's what it stands for. And basically what that magic function is going to be some bit of assembler, which maybe looks vaguely like this. That's not real assembler, but close to it, where it gets down to a single instruction, a compare exchange instruction that is one single instruction that you can't interrupt in between. So now we've gotten that instruction does the test of has it changed, and it does the set all atomically. That's why it's called atomics. It's an atomic operation that can't be separated and can't be interrupted. And you know, you can imagine how the CPU is going to do that and everything. And it's, you know, this is supposed to be a lock-free talk, and then the word lock shows up in a slide in the assembly. You know, that's not a normal lock. That's not really a lock. It's kind of a lock on the cache line, but it's not a lock in the normal blocking sense of the word. So I'm using the little atomic symbol now. Got to use your Unicode. So in C++, this CAS function is now called compare exchange, and it's a member function of atomics. And so you call it like this. You have your count, and you can compare exchange saying if it's still the old value, make it the new value. That's what the two parameters are. And so you can actually check the result of compare exchange. It'll tell you if it failed or not, right? So you try, and you say if it was the old value, make it the new value, and tell me whether you succeeded or not, right? So if it doesn't succeed, what would we do, right? It's like, oh, you know, count has changed behind our back, and so we don't write it. So, well, probably what we're going to do is go back to the top and retry. Got to have a go-to in every talk. And so what's happening here is you got this value count, and it's 17, and you look at it and say, 17, no, I would like to make it 18. You go to make it 18, it's like 24. What happened? So you go back to the top, and you go, okay, it's 24. Let's make it 25. It's like, oh, no, it's not 25. You know, you keep trying until you get a chance to, it's like everyone, it's like voting in election polls, right? Where it's like, I need to, you know, put in my vote. And if a vote says 17, it's like, well, I got to get in there, make it 18. But if someone else votes at the same time as me, it's like, stop, read the value again. Oh, okay, 24, I want to make it 25. Oh, no, it's 32 now? Okay, I want to make it 33. And eventually, you will get your chance to come in. Trying to stall as long as I can to keep that go-to up there. All right. So you probably write this as a do while. You know, this isn't real code, because anyone notice I'm using the word new as a variable name? Back in the days of C, I used new a lot as a variable name, and then C++ came around. And I was like, oh, man. And register, not like anyone uses a register as a keyword anymore. The committee has saved register. We're going to reuse it for something someday. We keep arguing about what we're going to use it for. Here's the interesting little tidbit. If it fails, you go back up and you read the count again, because you're going to try again, right? But you don't have to do that. You can do it like this, because the compare exchange, if it fails, updates old for you. Because it's like, I tried to read the count. You said, is it still 17? It wasn't 17, it's 24 now. So I'm going to tell you when compare exchange ends, it's like, oh, I've updated. I just saw those 24, so I might as well tell you it's 24. So you don't have to do the extra read there. That happens in the failure case. Old gets updated for you. Because everyone knows that's what you're going to do anyhow. And basically, this is the atomic plus-plus operator. It kind of looks like that. I mean, you don't have to say read mem, but I was trying to be very explicit. And really, it doesn't look like that. It probably looks like this, because you happen to be able to do increment in one instruction atomically. But the general style, the general structure is the important part, because maybe you want to, you know, do plus 5 mod 17, and there's no instruction for that. So this thing, the general structure here, is called the CAS loop. And whenever you're trying to update something with a new value, and there's not a atomics have plus plus built in, they have fetch add, like plus equals built in, they have a whole pile of functions built in, but if you're doing something that's not built in, you're going to write a CAS loop. And the way I like to think about CAS loop and pretty much anything in lock-free programming is act local and then CAS global, right? So you do all your work, whatever you're trying to calculate, in local variables, and at the very end, you publish your results with a CAS. That's the only, I mean, the read is kind of a global operation, but it's a read, no one cares. The only write of importance is a global write using a CAS. So act local, CAS global. And a question that comes up is like, how is this different than a spin lock? Like a spin lock where you just like wait for another thread to be finished or something. Because this spins around, right? It spins around waiting for someone else not to be touching the variable. So it kind of looks like it, how's it? It's still waiting on some other thread. But they're fundamentally different. So here's me trying to write the same thing with the left-hand side is a shortened, you know, scrunched up version of this code on the left. And I've stopped using new as a variable name. I'm trying to use the Norwegian. Not even gonna pronounce it, because I was looking at people pronouncing it to you. And on the right-hand side is a spin lock version of trying to increment a number. So you just have a lock variable that's either 0 or 1, and you wait, you try to set it, the while loop over there with the lock is saying, well, if it's zero, make it one. And if you succeed in making it one, that means you have grabbed the lock. If it's already one, the CAS fails, and you'll just sit there looping, waiting for it to become zero again. And then you increment, and then you exit. So those are the two things. Some people think they look similar. Some people think they're both polling, not in the voting sense, but polling on something. And polling is bad. But fundamental difference is that CAS loops when progress was made, and spin locks loop basically all the time. And let me, I like to explain that by, you know, looking at the one case, looking at a spin lock. Say you have two threads doing the same amount of code, and if one thread makes it to here, that means the lock was zero, and it, they set it to one, and they're happy, they're inside the lock. So another thread will come in, and it'll be stuck there, right? The lock for that second thread is now marked as one, and it can't get past, it'll just CAS and spin and burn through your CPU, terrible thing. So worst case though, what happens if the first thread that got in pauses by the scheduler, right? Well, then the second thread, well, doesn't pause by the scheduler, it just burns your CPU waiting for the first thread to be unpaused, right? So the first thread is doing nothing because of the scheduler, and the second thread is doing nothing because the first thread's doing nothing. That's blocking. That's fundamentally what blocking is, right? It's you're waiting and the other guy's doing nothing. So that is how a spin lock loops even when no progress is being made by another thread. Now if we look at the CAS loop, if one thread gets to the bottom, like the first two, three lines of code, both threads can do it at the same time. There's no contention. They're both reading, that's fine. And then they get to the bottom and they're both at this last line. If the thread on the right here fails, it only fails because the thread on the left succeeded. If the thread on the left just pauses on that line, then the thread on the right won't wait for it. It'll succeed. So CAS loops succeed when they CAS loops only fail when they succeed. The only time one loop will fail is when the other loop has succeeded. So someone made progress. It might not be the thread on the left that made progress, the thread on the right made progress. But the thread on the left will only loop around if the thread on the right did something. So you only loop when progress was made. So you're guaranteed that one thread has done something. It might not have been your thread, but one of the threads did something. So spin lock, you can both be sitting there doing nothing, but in a CAS loop, one of you is doing something guaranteed. And that, in fact, is the definition of lock-free programming. An algorithm is lock-free if at least one thread is guaranteed to be making progress, right? It's kind of a simple thing, but it's a very fundamental concept. You can't wait for another thread to do anything. And it's so tempting that you're in an algorithm somewhere and you're like, oh, this thread is just about to like set that thing and I'll just wait for it. It's like, no, because one thing is guaranteed making progress and you won't get deadlocks and all these other kind of things. You can get live locks if you write a bad algorithm. But the other thing about lock-free programs is they're very robust to people doing stupid things like killing a thread, right? If you kill a spin lock while it's inside the lock, the other threads are dead forever because they're going to wait on it forever, right? If you have two threads doing a CAS loop and one is just killed, which again, you should never do, but if one is killed for some reason, the other one will just keep going, right? It's, if you get out of my way, I'll even go faster. Beyond the benefits of hopefully being faster and hopefully avoiding deadlocks and stuff, lock-free programs are more robust to strange things happening. And you can do better than lock-free. There's this thing called wait-free, which says all threads are guaranteed to be making progress. Basically, a wait-free algorithm won't have a CAS loop in it. It won't loop back around when someone else succeeded. They will all keep going. So wait-free algorithms are very like, you know, just don't share any data and go. And they're harder, so I'm not even talking about them. There's another thing called obstruction-free, which is almost like lock-free. Basically, Every wait-free algorithm is lock-free. Every lock-free algorithm is obstruction-free. Obstruction-free is the easiest one. It's still pretty useful, maybe not as useful as lock-free. It's kind of weird. It's like, well, if there were no other threads running, then this one would have succeeded. What usually obstruction-free stuff does is it kind of reads ahead and even will write stuff, you know, globally, and then at the, you know, do a bunch of actions, and at the end check if anyone else had come around, usually by having having a counter somewhere or something. Is like, hey, I'm thread 100, and I'm like the thousandth time we've come through here. You do a bunch of actions, and at the end of it you check, hey, is it still like at 1,000, or is someone else here at the same, was someone here while I was here? And if you did do any writes, you just have to like roll back. So an obstruction-free algorithm knows how to roll back itself. And that can give you some interesting benefits. It's nice sometimes in a queue, when a queue, if you're trying to read, you know, a queue of integers, well, you can read an integer out as an atomic variable because an int is very small. But if you've got a queue of big structs, you can't read that whole struct in one operation. So you read the whole struct, and then at the end, check if your read was successful or not. Like, has anyone else written while I was reading? And that, of course, is undefined behavior in C++, because you can't read while someone else was writing if it's not atomic, if the variables aren't atomic variables. So there's a proposal right now in the committee by J.F. Bastian called Terrible Atomics. He is the best at puns in the committee. That's its job. Because you want to be able to tear, like to have reads that tear, where you're reading while another guy's writing the other half of it. You want to be able to do that read, which is totally undefined behavior. If you can somehow guarantee, I won't actually do anything. I'm just mem copying. I'm not going to actually use the variable until I check that the read was successful somehow. But it's really hard to write that in legal standardese such a way that's like, okay, it's UB, but it's not UB yet. It'll be UB lines later. You know, like, it's really hard. But hopefully we'll get Terrible Atomics someday. So I'm only talking about lock-free, but there's the three of them you should know about. This slide intentionally blank. That's what my comment says in my notes. So let's do something with this lock-free stuff. Let's make a lock-free stack, because that is the simplest thing in the world you could do. So basically, a lock-free stack is going to have a head that points to a bunch of nodes, and we're going to just need to write push and pop, right? Simple. So push. Obviously, we're going to allocate a new node. There's the new node. We're going to, look at what the old head was. And we will set up the new node to point to the old head. It's going to be the second in the stack. And then we just update stack head. And of course, we have a problem that, what if head has changed between those two lines of code? We read it, and then we're going to write it. And if someone else came in there in between, then our new head next will be pointing to the wrong place. Did my next slide even show that? So you must forget what you know. You think you know where the old head is, but what if halfway through this instructions, that second node, or what's about to be the second node, gets deleted on you by another thread? You are trying to set up this little, you want it to end up looking like this when you set the head to the new head. Your thing will be set up. But meanwhile, head has moved on to the second node because someone deleted the first one, and now you're creating a chain with a deleted node in the middle of it. So that's not good. So who's our friend? Who's going to solve this problem for us? Kaz. Kaz. It's the only instruction we know, right? It's the only instruction there is, basically. So we take our, let's just cut and paste. We take our count code, and we change it to code that knows how to update head, right? So we come in and we point, the new node is going to point to the old head, and then we're going to CAS, and we're going to say, hey, if head has moved, head was pointing at the dotted line, but if it's changed, then don't update head because something happened. Something has changed behind our backs. Instead, loop around and try, and we'll try to reset up the new node again. So the first time around, you know, head was pointing at the dotted line. New node was set up to point at that node that wasn't quite yet deleted. And then we notice it got deleted on us. We loop around a second time, and then we point to the, we see the blue arrows, and we set up new node, and we try the CAS again, and hopefully the CAS works the second time, right? And remember that old head is updated every time we do compare exchange. So, does that make sense? Simple, right? And that's it. That's how you do push. I think that's the last of push. Can't get any simpler than that. Literally, that is the simplest block-free thing out there. Those are just the line numbers matching the diagram, so that little 3 is the CAS operation there. So let's do pop, right? We can do push. How much harder can pop be? If your push and pop code look almost the same, you're probably doing something right. Everything that you want things to be symmetrical. So we're not going to allocate, but we're going to still need to get the old head. And then we're going to set up new head to be the one after the old head because we're going to about to delete that one. And right there, we've already walked off the earth, right? Because we're going to take the little dotted lines up there. We're going to read old head so we can see what old head next points to. But on that line of code, old head might already be gone. It might be deleted, right? Because anything could have happened between those two lines of code. And how are we going to fix that problem? We could do this. We could say, oh, if old head's null, then we must be empty and don't read it, blah, blah, blah. Of course, that doesn't solve anything. We've learned that by now. So don't even bother doing that if statement because, you know, if you check, it could be wrong on the next line after it. So instead, we're just going to wave our hands. Just ignore that problem. That's not even the problem I wanted to get to because that's a separate problem. So for now, imagine that you can read old head and that it's okay and your computer's not going to crash when you do that. And so let's do a compare exchange again. And we've now pointed, you know, that there's the CAS. It says if head is still pointing dotted line to that node, we'll swap it and head will now point to the new node, right? Does that make sense? Diagram. See what time I got left. And if something changed, like maybe while we were setting everything up, head actually points to the whole pile of new nodes over here and those old nodes are gone, then the CAS will fail. We look and say, hey, is head still where it used to point to? And we're like, oh my God, no, the whole queue has changed. So it'll fail and we'll loop around and we'll build it up again, right? Excellent. So that's how that works. But we have a bug. Beyond the fact that I read old head when it could be deleted, what's the other bug here? Anyone know the bug? Well, the first bug, it's good now I have a reading of the rooms because some people just know what the problem is here. Yeah? Hmm? Oh, yeah, the return too, yeah. Because old head might be gone. But we forgot to delete old head, right? Remember we allocated in the push, we got to delete it in the pop. So now that we've deleted old head, that those read, you know, before I did the delete, there wasn't really a problem with reading those nodes because I was just leaking them, right? Now it's even worse that I actually delete this memory that I want to walk across. But there's another problem. What if we come into this point in the code, we've got everything set up, we've got the new head ready to go, we've got the old head pointing to where it is, and now the node that we were trying to pop is popped by someone else and head points down to this new stuff. And we're like, okay, CAS is going to take care of that for us because head's pointing somewhere else. But then while we're still paused, because we could be pausing for years here, that node that was freed gets handed back to another thread in the allocator. So some other thread does a push, it calls new, it gets the exact same pointer back that was there before, right? But now you see that the whole node thing is pointing, there's this whole new linked list, and my little new head next isn't where, you know, that what that other node there was deleted. And when we do our CAS, CAS is going to go, oh yeah, that head pointer is pointing to the same place it's always been. Nothing has changed, right? Even though the whole stack has changed, head pointer doesn't look like it changed because that one pointer got recycled by your allocator, right? It's like, I was pointing here, and then for a while, the queue was pointing over here, and then now it's pointing back here again, but it's not the same node that used to be there. It's the same address, but everything has changed. The whole queue has, whole stack has changed. And this is called the ABA problem, because the head was A, then it became B, and then it came back to A, and you look at it, and you go, has it changed? It's like, oh no, it's still A, nothing's happened. And it's a fundamental problem in compare exchange. We like to think compare exchange means, hey, if the variable hasn't been touched, then go ahead. No one's done anything behind your back. But it really only says if the variable's the same thing it used to be. It may have changed, but it's now the same thing it used to be. That's why it's called the ABA problem. It was A, it became B, and then it was A again. So if this doesn't make sense, I can have another way of explaining this. This is what I worked up the whole thing to get to this point. I hardly slept last night because I didn't work on slides. I worked on that. It took me hours to edit that. I don't know why. I used to work on Adobe Premiere and I didn't have Premiere with me too, so I had to use unnamed other editor. Okay, so ABBA, ABA, like it's obvious, right? So how do we fix this problem? We change the node pointer to be some magic class called node pointer that will probably be a struct that crams a pointer and a counter together. And hopefully that's small enough that it can be an atomic operation. And so what you do is every time you allocate a new node, you increment a counter on it. So if that memory gets reused by the allocator, it won't look like the same pointer anymore. It'll be a pointer used the fourth time and a pointer used the fifth time. So every time you allocate, you just increment a number, right? So now you still have the same problem, right? But your chances that you're going to take are much better because, you know, it's like how often do you, you know, roll over that integer and like land on the same pointer with the same integer? And you're like, ah, that's rare enough that everything's going to be okay. Just take a chance. And that's not the only way to solve this problem. There's a bunch of answers to this problem. Hazard pointers are a thing that you never used to be able to talk about because they were patented. But the patent expired. It's actually, hazard pointers are probably going to end up in the standard soon. And hazard pointers are basically, you don't delete the nodes right away. You put them in this list over here. So, because, you know, we can do push. Push didn't have problems. So the way you do pop is to push somewhere else. Push is the only thing you can write that doesn't have problems. So how do I solve pop? It's like, well, what other tool do I have? I've got push. So you make another stack over here that carries the things you would like to delete. And then some later time in your algorithm when you know no one else is there for whatever other reasons, you can then delete these hazard pointers. Because you can basically put things off to the side and keep track. Is anyone still seeing these things? And similarly, you can... you could just don't delete ever. That also works. I mean, some people do it where they just, once a node has been allocated, they recycle it on their own. They never give it back to the allocator. And then they can kind of maybe manage their recycling better because they know what's going on. Or you put usage counters on your you know, like the hazard pointers can maybe have a pointer count saying, is anyone walking in the stack right now? Atomic shared pointer is a new thing that might work here, which is basically, you know, putting a atomic shared pointer solves the problem of I can delete this, but it's not getting reused if someone else is looking at it, right? So atomic shared pointer is actually a really nice solution to this stuff. And there's other ways to solve this problem. Oh, and now getting near the end. This had to be I cut slides out to get 45 minutes here. FCD. FCD is fear, certainty, and doubt. Because you should be afraid of lock-free programming. You should have your doubts, and you should be certain that there's good reasons for why you're fearful and doubtful. So here's one of my favorite examples. That line of code that reads the value that the pointer is pointing to. That's two separate reads of memory, right? First, you have to read the value of P to know where it's pointing, and then you read the value of that P is pointing to, right? Does that make sense? Two separate. You read P, and then you read the value at P. So how in the world can a processor change the order of those two instructions? I'm going to read where it's pointing to. I'm going to read the value over there first, and then I'll read the pointer telling me that it's over there. That makes no sense, right? Yet processors do that, essentially. They reorder those two instructions. Not very many processors do that. Intel won't do that. Only like the DEC Alpha that no one uses does things like that. And basically the way to think about it, because every time you think about it, you're just like, this is impossible. You're sitting there right now thinking, is he not explaining that? And it's like, no, I'm explaining it. It's just impossible, right? But what happens is there's a bunch of ways this can happen, but if the pointer was already read recently, the CPU can say, oh, I just looked at that pointer a second ago, so I'm going to assume I know where it points to, and I'll you know, read ahead that other variable. And then I'll read the pointer because, you know, whatever. But it's whatever order they are in memory, right? If this one comes before the other one in memory, it might just reorder them. And it's like, oh yeah, I know what that value is, trust me. Because every CPU acts like it's single-threaded. That's unless you tell otherwise, it's going to run the world like it's single-threaded. So if it just wrote the pointer, then it's like, I don't need to reread it. I just wrote it, I know what it is. So it can do whatever it wants, assuming no other threads exist. Even though every CPU knows other CPUs are sitting right beside it, they work as if they're the only one there. Because if they didn't work that way, they'd be really slow. So this is, to me, one of the scarier bits. And I have next to no time. I didn't really explain release acquire semantics. So this is another typical thing you like to do, like in a singleton or something, which are terrible things to do. Don't use singletons. But if you set up a couple of data things, and then you last thing you want to do is set the store, right? Set the ready variable to say, yeah, the data is ready. And then the other side will read the ready flag. And if it's true, then it knows the stuff is ready and it can read them, right? So I'm using release and acquire semantics there. If you don't say that's like a short form of memory order release. If you don't say release and acquire, you get stronger semantics, but you want at least release. And release says any code that happened before actually happened before, and it won't get reordered that X and Y happen after setting the ready flag. And acquire means anything that happens after really happens after. Don't speculatively read ahead on the data until you've seen the ready flag. Okay, that's normal lock-free code, if normal is possible. Word for lock-free programming. So here's an example of a very similar thing. Say you have some non-atomic data, and then you have a bool to say that it's initialized, right? So you set your non-atomic data, and then you set the bool saying, yep, it's ready. And then someone else can read, say, hey, if it's ready, I'll read the data, right? That's fine. And then someone else, so that gives you the relationship between, you know, this code happened before that code, if the if statement was true. Says so in the standard. But now someone else comes along and says, oh, you know, I need to do some accounting about, I need to keep track of these non-atomic data things that we initialize. I just want to do some bookkeeping on it. So it's going to make another bool keeping track of counting these things. And for whatever crazy reason, like this is too small of an example. It's hard to come up with an example that's pseudo-realistic. But imagine it had to do a bunch of work, so it's going to like do it on a separate thread, right? It's going to say, if it's initialized and no one's counted it yet, then I will keep track of it. Maybe it logs, does whatever it wants to do, and it's going to mark it as counted. Oh, yeah, it's going to mark that it's done the accounting on that item. You know, okay, good. And still, the other thread over there keeps working the way it always did. Nothing's changed yet. Someone else has just added a little bit of bookkeeping. Now, say someone took this code on the left and said, "Oh, I don't need two atomic variables, initialized and counted. I can cram that together into one atomic variable," which is usually a good thing to do because you can't read more than one atomic thing at a time. So they're like, "I'm going to save on an atomic here, cram this into a state." So we've got the anitted state and the unanitted state. That's why it's called un, and the counted state, right? And we combine these two bools into a thing. So now the guy who anits the data marks it as anitted, and the guy who does the accounting marks the data as counted, right? Makes sense? It's kind of a transformation of the same logic. And so bring that over to the left, and we go back to the user code. It was looking at initialized before, and you know now it can say if the state is anitted or better, right? If it's anitted or counted, because counted happens after anitted, then we can read the data. Does that make sense to everyone? No problems with that? Yeah, we're trying to say that's okay. Yeah, equivalently. Yeah, I could have done it as bits if I wanted to. Same thing. And we hope that this relationship holds, but it doesn't. This is undefined behavior. Probably undefined behavior. This is what the committee argues about. This is what SG1 group argues about things like this. It's like, didn't that make sense? I thought it made sense. And then they're like, no, that doesn't make sense. It's actually undefined behavior. Because what happens here is that pink arrow, triple arrows, is only true if the user thread reads the value written by thread one. If it reads the value written by thread two, the guarantees are off, right? And it's like, yeah, but I know thread two happened after thread one. Yeah, well, that doesn't mean thread three sees what thread one did. It might see what thread two did, but not see what thread one did yet, which is really weird and scary. But the way I think of this is imagine these are like separate computers across the internet, and you know, thread one is in Japan, and thread two is in Australia, and thread three over there is in, you know, Seattle. And the message got from thread one to thread two, from Japan to Australia, and then this message got from Australia to Seattle. But the message that got there, that got across from Australia to Seattle, was just that it's been counted. It didn't get the rest of the message that the atomic data was set. So the atomic data part was only sent, you know, from Japan. So yeah, this is undefined behavior. And when I first looked at it, I thought, oh, this makes complete sense. And then it's like, oh, wait a second. It doesn't make sense in this crazy world of threading or lock-free programming. Because this is the relationship that might happen, and there's no guarantee on this relationship. That little arrow is no longer true. And my last, you know, FCD example, this isn't even a lock-free example. Berkeley did this, you know, wrote an OS, basically, you know, school project kind of thing. And one of the main parts of this project was to do all best practices. They had design reviews, code reviews, nightly builds, regression tests, automated code coverage. I think they had 100% code coverage. Doesn't mention that there. Oh yeah, 100% code coverage. For the kernel parts, they had experts come in and review their code, right? All the tricky code. It ran for 3 years before it deadlocked. 4 years. 4 years before they found a bug. Bug was there all along, no one saw it, right? And I've had cases like, I've had not 4 years, but I've had code in Premiere actually where it had to run for a couple of days straight, and our like kind of lock-free allocator that we wrote would screw up, and the head pointer would be messed up. And we're like, and there was two lines of code that set head pointer. It was either set here or set there. And me and another guy sat staring at two lines of code for hours, literally hours, just going, oh, I know what's going on. This, and this is happening. And then we get into this state, and that's why it's null. And I'm like, no, that can't happen. Oh, yeah, that can't happen. Stare. Like, and we came up with like 12 different reasons why we thought this thing, and we finally changed to fix the problem. Say, oh, yeah, we need this, change the way we read the variable here, blah, 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 blah. And I think like 6 months later, I was like, wait a second. Our reason, you know, our answer was right, but the reasons were wrong. Like, we left a huge comment in this code this big, and it's like three lines of code. It's kind of like just like the stack I was showing. It's not much different than that, but there was like this long paragraph of why this read needed to be done a certain way. And then later on, I'm like, I don't think that's the right reasons. That's not what's going on, but it's, you know, the result's the same. So it's a scary thing that code can run. So writing tests to check lock-free code is almost impossible, right? You need like provability things if you want to know that it's right. So, okay, I'm finishing here. Guide to lock-free to threaded coding, not even lock-free coding. Stop sharing your data. Forget what you learned in kindergarten. Don't share. Use locks if you have to. If you do use locks, don't call unknown code while holding locks. I give a whole talk on that. Because you don't know what that code's going to do, like grab another lock and get you into a deadlock, which means don't call virtual functions, don't call callbacks, things like that. Measure, right? The reason you're using threads is probably to get better performance. Measure again, because the first time you measured, you got it wrong. It's almost guaranteed. Measuring is hard. Change your algorithm. Go back to one. Stop sharing data. Change your algorithm to make it faster. So that's the algorithm. Where's lock-free in this algorithm? Lock-free is down here at infinity. Lock-free is the last thing you want to do. And then if you do get there, don't forget to measure after. Because there's provable cases of like lock-free will be slower here. That's not always the right answer. It's never the right answer, actually. So don't share and use locks. Okay, and that is the end. Any questions? We're over time, but if you have questions, come to me after.